think what I always knew was that I wanted my life to be special, and I didn't know what that word meant. I had not much use for school, and they had less use for me, but we had some kind of a tacit agreement that I would get through it. I was always trying things. I did street theater and sang on the National Lampoon Radio Dinner album and sang background for people, and I was an usherette at the Vivian Beaumont, and I parked cars just to be near something theatrical, just to be near a place where I could possibly be discovered.
And Melissa Manchester was not only discovered, but has since gone on to become one of the most popular singer-songwriters in contemporary music. For the next 2 hours, Melissa will be sharing her life and career with you through her own words and music, beginning with the song that first put her name on the map.
I had two albums on Bell Records, and that was in the very early 70s, and music was in still a very creative place. Record making was in a very creative place. And then on the third album, when we changed producers, and I started to work with Vinnie Poncia, and I had written Midnight Blue with Carol Sager, and we wrote it for Dionne Warwick, and we sent it out to Vinnie because Carol knew Vinnie. And Vinnie got the demo, and he called Carol, and he said, "Who's the girl singer?" And as it turned out, I ended up making the third album with Vinnie Poncia. Dionne Warwick never recorded Midnight Blue, but I did. And it was quite extraordinary because there's this thing called the single vehicle, which is supposed to make all your dreams come true. Well, it makes one or two of your dreams come true. But it's interesting because it was interesting to be able to go on stage with people being able to recognize you for something before you even showed up.
Whatever.
Carol Sager and I got together quite by accident. I was singing background for Bette Midler, and it was her first big concert at Carnegie Hall, and I was the toots in the middle. Carol was at that concert, and she called me up the next day, and she said, "Were you the girl in the middle?" I said, "Yes." And she said, "Could you sing a demo for me of this song I've written?" So I went down to the studio, and I sang the song. And then she said, "Do you write at all?" She said, "Would you like to get together and write a few tunes?" So I said, "Sure," because I had been writing by myself primarily. Well, we got together, and what happened was that she and I were going through such huge changes in our lives, emotional changes, growing. Early 20s, uneven relationships, personal womanly changes. It was in the early 70s. So we wrote all of these songs that came gushing forth that were all very heartfelt and real survival notes to ourselves. And we did that for quite a few years, but I don't think either of us have achieved such personal involvement with any collaborators. We've done good work with other people, but that was such a role. I mean, that was so many songs, and that was such a chunk of time. It was so important, you know. When you're here,
we'll hear several songs from Melissa Manchester's latest album, Hey Ricky, right after these words.
Heard the latest? The refreshing crackle and crunch of fresh vegetables. The snap of carrots. The crunch of celery. The crackle of fresh pepper. In a new kind of soup. Campbell's Crispy Soup. Campbell's found a new way to keep crispy vegetables crispy in soup. Tangy Campbell's Crispy Soups. Tomato garden and Spanish-style vegetable. Delicious hot or cold. Give them a listen.
Stir up the Campbell's. Soup is good food.
We continue Melissa Manchester, Words and Music.
My latest album is called Hey Ricky, and it was produced by Arif Mardin. It has 10 songs on it, and, well, there are all kinds of tunes. There's rock and roll, and there's ballads. And Hey Ricky is the title cut of the album, and I wrote it with Bernie Taupin. Bernie is the only person that I've ever collaborated with who hands me finished lyrics, which is very different than the kind of collaboration I'm used to, which, well, if it's with Carol Sager or Kenny Loggins or Allie Wills or anybody, where you collaborate on the melody and the lyrics as it's being written. But Bernie is an extremely prolific writer. He brought me this lyric, and at first I was a little hesitant. I'm always a little hesitant with Bernie's lyrics because they're so rich, they're a little intimidating because you don't know how to approach them. and I couldn't get behind singing it at first. And then I realized that, like an actress, that the song is about a woman who has had it up to here with being manipulated by some creep, and or heel in this case. And that's what I used to help me get through singing, and it worked out just swell. I think history is real important to me, where I come from and how I grew up, and because I came from such a musical family and because there was such a great appreciation for all kinds of music, I was exposed to all kinds of music from infancy, whether it was my father practicing bassoon or my mother singing to me or singing with the radio. And when I was five and my father brought home the first LP for the first hi-fi, it was Ella Fitzgerald singing Gershwin. And she was saying, "Someone to Watch Over Me." Well, the song just never left me. And over the years, I think part of the key to endurance and perseverance in this line of endeavor is to hope that if you play your cards right, somewhere along the line, you'll be able to do the kind of music that turned you on, that started you off as a child. There is always a cut on the album. It'll never be a single. Who knows if anybody will even listen that far into the album. But it's for me, and it's for those who would listen that far, and it's to acknowledge the geniuses, the master craftsmen who really made their impression on me, you know, the Gershwins and Lawrence Hart and Richard Rodgers and Hoagy Carmichael. I don't know if we'll ever be in a time again where that kind of writing is encouraged. This is Melissa Manchester, and I'll be right back in a moment.
The Melissa Manchester special continues.
I started making commercials when I was about 15. My brother-in-law had hired me. He was writing commercials, and he hired me to sing on them. And it was very lucrative. It helped me to support a band for many years. As I was doing all the college coffee houses and the toilets and the theaters and circuses and stuff like that. And I started writing when I was about... I started writing poetry when I was about 14, but I started writing songs when I was about 17. It was while I was at NYU School of the Arts and I was studying acting. And so I tried to write songs. And of course, when you're just starting to do anything, it's like the floodgates opening. And every time I heard something, it was a song. And I tried for many, many years to get a recording deal and got turned down. And then I studied songwriting for about 8 weeks with Paul Simon. That was quite extraordinary to be able to learn from somebody who was doing it. And then finally, when I was right after I had left working with Bette, I only worked for her for about 6 months, I got a recording deal.
We'll hear more stories and music from Melissa Manchester after this. We continue with more words and music of Melissa Manchester. One of Melissa's most successful songs resulted from a collaboration with Kenny Loggins.
Whenever I Call You Friend came about because for 1 year, Kenny and I kept seeing each other at these award presentation dinners and shows and stuff. And, you know, we finally looked at each other and said, we really ought to do something sometime, travel or do a show together or write something. And I guess I called him up and said, you know, you want to write or what? And he came over to the house, brought a bottle of wine. And it was very interesting to write with him because I don't know if it pertained just to this one song or as it's a rule for him, but he didn't write the song on guitar or piano or anything. He just hummed it to himself. And it's a very involved melody. I couldn't imagine anybody walking around humming a whole finished melody to yourself. I mean, and be able to talk to people, you know, it's very difficult. And then as I was trying to figure out the chords on the piano, I kept saying, you've been walking around with this in your head? I mean, you must have a tremendous headache. So we worked on it, and then when we finished it, it sounded like a real nice kind of James Taylor tune for me, to me. We do it in the show, and it's a lovely song. Ooh, There's always something special about singing a duet, whether it's on an album or whether it's on stage or whatever, because people can hear you connect with another human being through their voice and through music, which is very telling. And when I first heard Wish We Were Heroes, which was written by a man by the name of Austin Gravelding, I will never forget this name. It sounded like a duet. I mean, it sounded really like a duet. Actually, what it sounds like is a movie theme, because some of the lyrics are kind of, well, they are descriptive of a final scene from a movie. So they contacted David Gates. He drove in and we got the key together and it worked out. Somewhere down This is Melissa Manchester, and I'll be returning with more of my music and stories after this.
Melissa Manchester made Academy Awards history when she recorded in the same year two of the nominated movie themes, Ice Castles and The Promise.
Originally, what happened with Through the Eyes of Love, the theme from Ice Castles, was that at the time, Carol Sager was living with Marvin Hamlisch, and he was doing a concert at the L.A. Bowl, I believe, and it was called Marvin Hamlisch, An Evening of the Music That He Loves, or something else. And I kept thinking about, but what about the music that we love, Marvin? Anyway, so he called me up and he said, would you do me a favor and sing this song? And that was the first time that I'd ever heard the song, the first time I sang it, and it was kind of nice. And then it came time for the movie, and he asked me if I would sing it for the movie, which was fine. And around that same time, Marilyn and Alan Bergman and David Shire had written the theme from The Promise. Unfortunately, neither of these movies was so terrific, but the music was awfully nice. And of course, to be asked to sing both of them at the Academy Awards was really lovely. I went to the dress rehearsal, and of course, all these productions, there's something so sinister and sadistic about all of these big production shows, because they always have a staircase where you know somebody's gonna trip and die. And I had two staircases to walk down in a tight Bob Mackie dress, my first one in heels. Never mind that my knees were shaking and I was so tired I was hallucinating anyway. But it worked out fine and it was very nice. It was a nice experience. Say goodbye, why
I can barely sing. We'll hear more from Melissa Manchester after this. We continue with more of the special words and music of Melissa Manchester.
Race to the End has been released as an instrumental by Vangelis. It's the theme music from Chariots of Fire. John Anderson put lyrics to the theme, and we recorded it. It's very electronic, and it's very powerful, and I mean, for me, I would love to have it performed at the Olympics in 1984. I mean, I just think that would be grand. I think the lyrics are more poetic than lyric, really. You have to listen kind of closely to make sense of them. But they are very pertinent to the issue of running and the ultimate challenge of one challenging themselves to do the best you can and trying and going forth again, even when you've been defeated or whatever. It's very powerful.
We'll be right back with more of the words and music of Melissa Manchester. We continue with the words and music of Melissa Manchester. For her latest album, Hey Ricky, Melissa and Carol Bayer Sager once again combined their songwriting talents.
Carol Sager and I hadn't been able to get together for a long time because she's become a performer too. So we're always out of town, and it was time for the album, and I put out an emergency call, and she came over to the house. And we figured, well, we'll write a couple of tunes because it's been such a long time since we've written. Who knows if we have it anymore? And we've gone through so many emotional changes. Who knows if we even like being in the same room together? So she said, well, you know, I've got a couple of ideas and this and that. I said, well, why don't you just reel them off to me? And she went da-da-da-da-da-da. And she said, I'm looking for the perfect ah. I said, what's that? And we started to write it, and And it was grand. I mean, it was grand because the fire between us clicked in right away. And because we thought it would take a few tries, it happened right away. And the song is about the universal perfect 10. It's never quite that. It's an 8.5, if you're lucky. Or it's a few minutes out of a month when it's really swell, or maybe out of a few days. That's what it's about. I love to write with her because we can write about thoughts and dreams and fantasies and illusions and philosophies, you know, even though they're very simple songs, it's what they are. This is Melissa Manchester, and I'll be right back in a moment.
We continue Melissa Manchester, Words and Music.
I'll Always Love You was written by Tom Snow and Eric Kaz, and it's a beautiful song. It's also a duet, sort of. It's not quite as much a duet as Wish We Were Heroes, but it has a quality of two people singing together. Tom Snow sings with me on the choruses. And it's just a very dear, gentle love song. It's really in the tradition of a James Taylor love song, and it's just beautiful.
Standing by my window.
Melissa Manchester shares the story behind a tune that earned her a Grammy Award nomination.
Don't Cry Out Loud, I first heard on Peter Allen's live album. Peter wrote it with Carol Sager. It's funny because I've never written a song with Peter, but he's written songs with Carol and I've written songs with Carol. So it's like, you know, you don't know where one begins and one ends. But when I first heard the song, I was very moved by the lullaby quality of it. And when I recorded it, as I was singing it, I realized that because I was under a lot of emotional pressure at the time from the record company and in my personal life and stuff, the message of the song was starting to implode, and it became very much a cry of anguish for me and frustration, because actually the song is not what it says it's about. It's quite the opposite. And it worked for me. I guess people connected with the cry in my voice. But I remember after singing it, I drove home and cried and broke things and said, how can they do this to me? But it worked, you know.
Baby, cry the day the sleep is
gone. We'll continue with more of the words and music of Melissa Manchester after this. We continue with the Melissa Manchester special.
Playing Vegas is very interesting. I mean, if you would have asked me 5 years ago, will I ever play Vegas, I would have said, go on. But strange as it may sound, there's a lot to be learned from playing under those circumstances. It's the most difficult work I've ever had to do because it's 14 shows in 7 nights. And that's very tough. And after 15 years of doing this for a living, I'm just beginning to understand the word pacing and that it really means something. But it also affords me the luxury of using a full orchestra and drapes and a lot of money, which helps me to pay for the tour for the rest of the year. But it also teaches you about a very real sense of discipline. I mean, your days are extremely regimented. Your performances are extremely regimented. And I give the same amount of energy to an audience in Vegas as I do in Detroit, you know, at a free concert. It doesn't matter, because performing to me is an ultimate kind of experience. And it's such a shame to waste that. It's only an hour. And there are so many people who help to put it together, that to blow that hour for any reason, whether it's because my heel has broken or there's some jerk in the audience who is yelling through a whole show, or I'm not giving, or I'm tired, you know, or I have cramps, or a musician forgot to tune up, or something. It's so condensed. That hour of working is equivalent to weeks of work, because it's such a heightened experience. Orgasmic, for sure.
Somebody told me.
Just Too Many People. Melissa Manchester will be right back after this. We're back with more words and music of Melissa Manchester.
One of the reasons that I love doing live performances, there's much more understanding than there could ever be from just listening. You may think you understand what's going on when you're just listening, but to see somebody perform brings an added real life dimension. Plus the fact that I can sing the music that I want. I include tunes that are familiar because they've done well for me and by me, but people get to see me and they get to see the truest form of me. I don't think the truest form of me will ever be captured on record, which is interesting. It's just the nature of it. I just like singing to people. But it is interesting to work with people who love to make records. You know, it is very interesting to be with people who just know the technology and stay with it and learn every new sound and know every button combination and know every wire and know how to belch and they'll make it into music. I mean, it's just incredible. Whereas me, I guess I stopped listening on a very broad scale after it was more sounds than substance. I mean, it may have been substance, but there were so many sounds that I couldn't hear it anymore. You know, it's sort of like an old-fashioned appreciation for the people who wrote songs way back when. I know it's late. This is Melissa Manchester, and I'll be returning with more of my music and stories after this.
We continue Melissa Manchester, Words and Music, with the latest single released from her current album, Hey Ricky.
You Should Hear How She Talks About You was written by Tom Snow and Dean Pitchford, and it was brought to my attention by Arif Mardin, by way of Clive Davis, who's the president of Arista. And Clive likes to be involved with his artists. He would like to sing and play the drums if he could, but he can't. I won't let him. But he does suggest songs, and this is a rock and roll song that it's fun. It's kind of a neat point of view because it's the girl telling the guy about herself, but without telling him who she's talking about. And it's up, and it's peppy, and you can dance to it. And we had a good time doing it. When I had first started to meet with Arif Mardin, this was after a 7-year wait of wanting to work with him. And believe me, the wait was worth it. We were having dinner and we were kicking around song titles, what to put on this album. And he had said to me that he really regretted not being able to have recorded Coming from the Rain with me. And I said, well, don't let that stop you. And so we recorded Coming from the Rain, re-recorded it, and if we do a live album, we'll re-record it again. But it's that kind of a song. I mean, Carol Sager and I are very fortunate to have written the kind of song that gets acknowledged on a very broad scale. You know, you hear it in bathrooms and elevators and airplanes. It's great.
Well, hello there.
We'll hear more from Melissa Manchester after this.
I enjoy living in California now. I've been living here for about 6 years now. I think my spirit is still that of a New Yorker. But it's a very nice balance to come back to peacefulness, which California lends us, really. Because what happened, I mean, I was doing so much work in California, I finally had to move out to California. But also, living in Manhattan after coming off the road is like still being on the road. I mean, it was really getting a little too much, but it's still a sensational city. And I think I'll probably spend some time there. I'd love to be involved in something for Broadway. If I ever had to move back to New York, that's the reason I would use as an excuse, because I was working in something terrific there. And that's another thing about Vegas. I mean, it helps you with stamina. I mean, you think about people who do Broadway shows for years, every night except Sunday, and two shows on Wednesdays and Saturdays. It's a lot. It's a lot, and it leaves you very little personal life, and it's a whole other kind of living experience. Well, I'm getting married May 1st to Kevin DeRemer, and we hope to have a very busy, crowded, loving, adventurous, energetic life. And you never know what can happen.
Oh, no, Melissa Manchester, Words and Music, was produced by Narwood Productions. Ellen Silver, producer. Dave Levan, recording engineer. Executive producer, Ted Levan. Melissa Manchester, Words and Music, is copyrighted 1982 for the sole broadcast and use of the ABC Radio Network and may not be copied or offered for resale.